Okay, so let's now we are pretty much done with all this background information you need. Now let's talk a little bit about stability theory. Then I will let you go. I don't want you to go hungry. You know, I know you guys are. So we're really talking about dynamics instability when we talk about flutter. So let's suppose you have this axial bar and its motion is restrained by a spring K, and we apply a small force, apply a force P here, and we want to find out whether the new equilibrium position is stable or not. Okay. So when I apply this force P and there is a small rotation, the spring over here starts to apply a moment in the opposite direction, which is equal to K theta, right. So we are going to assume the rod is rigid, length L, and we will neglect its weight as a first step. It is supported by a smooth fixed pin at the base, and it is restrained by elastic rotation spring, which produces a restoring moment K theta. So if you write the governing equation in time, including what we just did in vibrations and all that, you have applied moment should be equal to the mass moment of inertia about the pin joint into d square theta over dt square. That is the governing equation, right. And the I is 1 over 3 m L square. So for the static equilibrium, we would have d square theta equal to 0 over dt square equal to 0, and you would have r L sin theta minus k theta equal to 0. So one of the solution is theta 1 equal to 0. So if you look over here, if I substitute theta equal to 0, I get a good solution. I have a solution, but that's a trivial solution. We want to see, are there other paths. So one other path would come out to be k over L theta over sin theta, that we would call secondary path. So as theta over theta goes to 0, theta over sin theta, I am sure you all know that approaches 1, right. So the equilibrium situation would look like this. You have nothing happening till theta equal to 0. At a certain value of p, at a certain value of p, then you get two more equilibrium paths, one going this way, one going that way. This point is called bifurcation point, okay, where you develop other possible solutions, which we are doing over here. And so at this point, the system bifurcates, and we do not know beforehand whether it would go on this side or it would go on that side. And this path is symmetrical about this line, okay. The intersection point is called bifurcation point, as I told you, and the intersection of two equilibrium paths in the load deflection plane. Okay, that's the bifurcation point. Now, then what you want to study is the existence of adjacent equilibrium state in the vicinity of primary equilibrium path, and that is called structural stability or onset of buckling. And it's very similar to what we talked about divergence. So it is very important you understand the meaning of stability theory. So for very, very small angle, small theta analysis, the path would look like this. This is the real path, though. This is when I do not make small theta analysis, but if I assume sin theta to be equal to theta, this is what I would get. Okay? As if I go a little bit to the right, I would get the same force. But I can have an equilibrium at a slightly different theta than 0. When your line is like this, we call it neutrally stable. Okay? The actual system really is stable, because in the actual system, if I want to increase the value of theta, I will have to increase the value of p. When you have to increase the value of p to get a higher theta, those systems are generally stable. So this is really a stable path, whereas this path is what you would call a neutrally stable path, because if I place force over same force, but if I place over theta over here, I would still get an equilibrium at the same p. I'm not going down. If for some reason I had a path which would take me a lower value of p, then that would be an unstable situation. Okay, so is intersected, therefore bifurcation point is same as in large theta analysis, but and P critical is same. So, we get a very accurate value of the P critical, but we are getting somewhat different properties of the stability theory, stability property. If we now do a dynamic analysis, you have I theta double dot plus k theta minus p l sin theta equal to 0. And let us suppose theta is now from the equilibrium point, it is a small perturbation which is a function of t. This is what happens in flutter, that you have the wing is flying at some static equilibrium and you give it a disturbance which is a function of time, and you want to see if that disturbance would be stable or unstable. So, the equation then become k theta minus p l sin, that is our equilibrium, and phi t is a small angle, and let us see what happens to that. So, we substitute everything in our governing equation, then simplify it, this is what we get. Okay. Now, this part, not this part, this part is same as what we had before. So, but if you compare the coefficients, but this is a new part that we are getting. One of the things you want to learn when you do stability analysis is you have to go away from assuming cosine phi equal to 1 when phi is small. If you do that, you will not get much information. You always have to replace cosine phi with 1 minus phi square over 2 plus something which is of the order of phi 4. Similarly, do not write sine phi simply as phi when phi is small. Also write the cubic term. Okay. Otherwise, you will not be able to make any progress, or you will not be able to say anything about what your stability looks like. So, what we are going to do is we will replace our cosine phi and sine phi with these phi square phi cube terms, and when I do that, we get this as our equation. And we simply ignore phi 4 term, phi 5 term, and we only stay up to phi square, and this is what we get. Okay, this is what we get. Then for small phis, for phi t small, we get the governing equation to be I 0 phi dot plus k minus p l cosine phi 0 phi equal to 0. And this is what you would call sort of what we have been calling omega square kind of term. So, you have phi double dot plus omega square equal to 0, omega square is 1 over I 0 k minus p l cosine theta. So, phi t, phi t then is of the form of a 1 sin omega t plus a 2 cosine omega t if omega square is greater than 0. Okay. So, what do we see as omega square, which is 1 over I 0 k minus p l cosine theta, it will decide what phi would look like. If k is greater than this, omega square would be positive. If k is equal to this, this would be 0, and your term would be phi double dot equal to 0. And if k is less than p l cosine phi, then it would be like having a minus sign here and some positive term over here. So, you get three different solutions depending on how k is related to p l cosine theta 0. So, if k is omega square comes to be greater than 0, we get it to be in a sinusoidal response, and that is what it is. Okay. If omega square is equal to 0, the response is like this, it just keeps on increasing with time, but it is sort of, it is not oscillatory, but it is increasing with time in a linear fashion. If omega square is less than 0 and omega, we represent omega bar square as minus omega square, our response looks like a 1 e omega bar t plus a 2 e omega bar t, and this response is now omega bar is positive, remember that. Okay. Because omega square was negative, so this is really is a response that is continuously increasing in time. So, this is a classic instability, this also is an instability, but this is a mild compared to what you have over here, because see how rapid this is increasing exponentially, whereas this is increasing linearly, but it is an instability nevertheless, because a small, what it means is if I give a small disturbance to this system, if k is bigger than p l cosine theta 0, I will simply get an oscillations about that point. If it is a p l equal to k, I would get a response phi would gradually keep on increasing, and again it is, but this one is a really bad case, that it simply grows like crazy, and this is what happens in flutter. Okay. So, our amplitude of the vibration would sort of take off and it would go to infinity very fast. So, for infinitesimal and arbitrary phi 0, it also depends on initial conditions. We will get bounded motion if omega square is greater than 0, we know that. We get unbounded motion if omega square is less than 0. So, that is the key point. And it is, if omega square is greater than 0, it is a stable situation. It is a critical situation if omega square is exactly equal to 0, and it is unstable if omega square is less than 0. So, that is the definition of critical, stable, unstable situation. So, it depends on how omega square is. So, if p is less than k over l, p is equal to k over l, p is greater than k over l, you get three different situations. So, for this case, critical value would be equal to k over l. K is the stiffness of that torsional spring, and if you divide that with l, it would have units of force, and if p is equal to k over l, we will not have, we will have a critical situation, but if p is less than k over l, if you give it a small disturbance, it will come back to its original condition, because spring would bring it back. Spring will not bring it back if you have the compressive load is so high that it is greater than k over l, then if you give a small disturbance, you will never come back to your original condition, and it would be an unstable situation. So, for p equal to k over l, theta 0 sin theta 0, this is our omega 0, 1 minus theta 0 over tan theta 0 is stable, 0 would remain between 0 and pi, it's critical, theta 0 equal to 0, and unstable for theta less than 0 between 0 and pi. Okay. So what it means is that depending on the value of k, the p will decide for different values of theta 0 whether the system is stable or not. But again, once again, it all depends on this number k over l into 1 minus theta 0 over tan theta 0. So it's dependent on the initial condition, initial angle. So, stability does depend sometimes on the initial point. It is not always around a theta equal to 0 point. In this case, this is one possible solution, these are the other solutions. These points are all stable points and these are all unstable points. What this means is, let us say you are on this point, if you give it a small disturbance, it would immediately either go to this angle or it would go to that angle. But if you are already here, after that it would remain stable. That means, if you give it a small change in theta, it will stay on this path, but not over here. Okay. So, this is an unstable path. So, in dynamics, in stability problems, at a certain value of load called critical point, you can get several types of response. Over here, you have three possibilities. You can go either on this branch, these are called branches, this is called bifurcation point, and these two branches are stable. That means, a small disturbance will bring you back to this path, but this is an unstable path. A small disturbance will not bring you back, it would either immediately take you over here or to the left. So, the rigorous stability analysis confirms that the bifurcation point is the onset of buckling, loss of stability on p 1 for p greater than k over l. Okay. So, what is the dynamic method? The method of stability analysis, the dynamic method is, what is the value of the load for which the most general free motion of the perfect system in the vicinity of equilibrium position ceases to be bounded. Okay. So, if omega square is greater than 0, we saw it is a stable equilibrium. If omega square is equal to 0, it is critical equilibrium. If omega square less than 0, it is unstable. The method people use is called adjacent equilibrium method. That is, what is the value of load for which the perfect system admits non-trivial equilibrium configuration. Okay, we will see that more in both divergence, in flutter and in buckling. Buckling and divergence are very much related. So, that is why before you can learn divergence, you really need to revisit buckling. So, in this case the adjacent equilibrium method is you are at equilibrium, you give a small disturbance and then see are you able to come back. Remember in the first day we did a simple example, we had the airfoil section and it was in equilibrium and I gave a small disturbance and I asked myself what is the restoring moment and what is the moment that will keep on moving it. And we found that for a certain value of speed, that if I give a small disturbance, the restoring moment was greater than the moment that would make it keep on going, right. So, same thing, that is what we are talking about. So, it is repeating what we talked about on the first day, but now we will go into more details. The other method is the energy method. That says what is the value of the load for which the potential energy ceases to be positive definite, that it is no longer relative minimum. But we do not use the energy method. For us this method is a pretty good one, and that is the one we will keep on using. And I think we will stop here. I know you guys are hungry, but then next time we are going to talk from the elastic column, and then we will go from there. Okay.